Welcome to another episode of Rock You Like a Hurricane Rana. My name's Simon Tackler. My co-host, of course, Owen Jones, Digital Beard. Hello.
Hello. How are we?
Oh, man. Doing very well.
That's good. It's been a fun little week. We've had a little bit of a nice little bit of a pump up in ratings.
Yes. Thanks to everyone who listened to last week's show. That might have been our biggest show ever in a lot of ways.
Absolutely.
A bunch of massive guests. We had AJ Styles, Carmella. We had Alex from Kill Your Stereo.
The biggest of guests.
We did what we said we were going to do at the start. We spoke about wrestling. We spoke about music.
Yep.
And we hope people who listened enjoyed a bit of both.
Yeah, thank you to Carmella for actually retweeting the show.
Absolutely.
That was a bit of a surprise. I was at work and I'm like, why am I getting like 60 Twitter notifications? I'm like, oh, that's why.
Hey, she was a big fan of the show, it seems.
She was great. It was good.
Yeah. So that was cool. Of course, if you want to hear that, if you haven't heard it, subscribe to the podcast. Find us on iTunes.
Yeah.
Or wherever you find us.
Stitcher. Online. We should get on Spotify.
We will get on Spotify.
I'll look into it.
I think that's next.
Yeah. Our world domination is slowly creeping up.
World domination comes a little bit after that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And continuing on last week's theme of taking a look back at the year so far in music, this week, we're going to take a look back at the year so far in wrestling.
Yeah, and it's been big.
Because 2018 continues to be the strangest year I can remember for pro wrestling.
I think so.
Especially in a positive way.
Oh, yeah.
When it comes to positives, I feel like wrestling hasn't been in this good of a state for 20 years, basically, it feels.
I think so.
You know?
Yeah.
And it just continues to get better and better. So I think we've got to start in January, the biggest event that kicks off every year, Wrestle Kingdom.
Yes.
And you were there.
I was there for this one. It's just that whole week in, even 2 weeks, but that whole week in Japan, in Tokyo, is just the most insane thing I think I've actually like witnessed. Because like you've got so many, because obviously there's so many promotions like and decent promotions in Japan anyway. And every night there's shows on. At Corrigan Hall. So, like, you'll start... Like, we got there on the 2nd of January and we went straight to a big Japan wrestling show. And then the next night was DDT. And then it was Wrestle Kingdom. And then it was New Japan again. And then it was, like, 0-1, fucking Noah, Wrestle 1. All these promotions have shows during the week. So, if you go for a week, you're going to see wrestling every night.
And now you know, I mean, we spoke about it when you first went, but now having been to WrestleMania and Wrestle Kingdom, the Wrestle Kingdom week sounds a lot like Mania week in that
it really is.
It becomes a festival of wrestling in general.
It literally is, yeah. And like you bump into people from around, you bump into wrestlers from all around the world like that you know of, and it's like the coolest thing ever.
Yeah.
But yes, Kingdom was the most insane. It didn't even feel like a 6-hour show though. Because like we got there and the Rumble starts at 4 o'clock. And obviously we saw Gino Gambino, Mr. Juicy, MCW's heavyweight champion, now there.
And that's one of the main things we have to touch on first as a highlight, especially for Australian wrestling. For an Australian performer to be in the Wrestle Kingdom Rumble, to be a member of the Bullet Club.
To eliminate Taka Michinoku.
To eliminate legend Taka Michinoku, legit legend Taka. Yep. It's just wild, and I guess we can talk about more of what Mr. Juicy has done for the Australian scene a little later on.
Yeah, absolutely.
As we continue through the year. But
for
Wrestle Kingdom as well, of course, one of the craziest things to happen is that Chris Jericho, who in a way is still a signed WWE performer.
He's WWE's golden haired child.
He says literally some type of deal with them, was, you know, able to perform at Wrestle Kingdom.
Against Kenny, like the best wrestler in the past 10 years, Kenny Omega.
He's the best bout machine. He just has good matches with everyone.
And I was really skeptical. I wasn't convinced. I wasn't sure about this match. Because I went into this... So I went to Wrestle Kingdom like knowingly that I was seeing my favorite wrestler, Hiroshi Tanahashi, wrestle. That's all that mattered to me. I'm like, I'm seeing my favorite wrestler. I don't care. And then... And I still wasn't convinced with the whole... Because I wasn't sure how Jericho would adapt to the New Japan. Because he wrestled New Japan, what, 25 years ago?
A long time.
And I was just so I didn't like it live. Didn't like it.
Yep.
Wasn't too convinced. I think it wasn't as good. I thought the main event was a better match, but I went back and watched it when I got back to Australia, and I'm like, oh no, it was really good.
I feel like it might have definitely been a TV-style match in that one that's better to watch on TV.
Yeah.
Because a lot of it had to do with things that were happening close up. Their facial expression, the trash talking.
Yeah.
Jericho just letting loose with the, you know, like no rating and just being able to swear and trash talk.
Oh,
the whole
yeah,
time.
Yeah. I think that's what Jericho likes New Japan so much.
Just throwing, you know, cameras and reporters and pushing people and getting to be an old school, you know, gaijin bully in Japan. And
pretty much.
Adapted to the role. It was funny hearing him talk after the match because a lot of people mentioned that Jericho looked slightly out of shape or his body shape was different. He said he put on mass on purpose because he wanted to look like, you know, the big old school white guys who would go to Japan and just be brawlers. So,
yeah, like Vader was and stuff, and like Scott Norton.
Exactly. So that was a nice little touch. So we got, you know, Jericho being a mini version of like Stan Hansen or whatever. Some people consider it Jericho's best match. I don't know if I'd go that far, but it was definitely halfway through still one of the best matches of the year for different reasons.
But see, that night though, there was three matches that were also absolutely astonishing, which was the junior heavyweight fatal four-way.
Yep.
That was incredible.
So you had Ospreay, Marty Scurll, Kushida.
And Hiromu Takahashi.
What a crazy match.
And Ospreay did the moonsault off the 12 feet up the scaffolding. It was insane.
That was crazy. And then the main event, I feel like going in, expectations were sort of like, oh, they can't top last year's Wrestle Kingdom main event. I love the main event.
That main event. I do remember me, former guest Sean Hawkins, were just losing our mind at how good that match was.
Yeah, Naito and Okada.
Oh, it was such a good match. Like, because it was so different. Because, like, obviously, like, the last Wrestle Kingdom main event was, like, so prominent. Like, and it set up the last 2 years of pro wrestling, pretty much. A year and a half of pro wrestling. And then you look at Naito versus Okada, it was so different because it was the, like, again, those two are back at Wrestle Kingdom main eventing.
Yeah,
and Naito was going for the title instead of defending the title, and it was I really loved that match, and I'm very happy that Naito is just a machine.
Yeah, and a lot of people are saying that maybe this sets up Naito versus Omega at next year's Wrestle Kingdom. I don't know if it's going there. But
Naito winning the G1, maybe.
Yeah, wins it back to back, and then actually wins the title this time.
Yeah,
to send Kenny to America to make millions of dollars, and for people to bitch that it's not as good as he used to be.
You think it'll happen? Do you think it'll happen?
It could. I don't know. If I was Kenny, and the rumors are true that he's got a giant offer waiting for him.
Yeah, I've heard like six.
Hey. This is the time to take the money and run, because if WWE needs a centerpiece for the new SmackDown with a new audience on a new network,
yeah.
Hey, you got that Fox money, do you?
Yeah, that makes lots of sense. I haven't even thought about that.
Or the rumors that NXT is moving to Fox Sports 1, which would make it a legit TV show now. Do you need bigger stars? I don't know.
I would have Omega straight to the main roster.
Absolutely.
You'd have to.
Yeah. Either way, that was Wrestle Kingdom.
And then you got the Royal Rumble as well. Royal Rumble was the debut of Ronda Rousey. She came and destroyed everyone. And
the first women's Royal Rumble,
which I actually liked more than the men's one.
They main evented the show, and I think
as soon as they main evented the show, you knew Rousey was coming out.
Yeah.
Like, for sure.
It felt like that would happen. They did a great job. There was a lot of female legends in the match.
Michelle McCool was best on ground by a fucking... She had like 7 eliminations. It was amazing.
Those Undertaker powers. She's just got them. She's part of the family.
She's absorbed his greatness in a Rumble.
I should have did that. I wish he came out with his entrance and everything.
Yeah.
That was a lot of fun. Asuka won the Women's Royal Rumble.
I hated the finish, though. The finish was so weird.
Just pulling Nikki out like Nikki was the hardest person to eliminate.
And then, averagely kicked her off the off the apron.
But that was it. Yeah. She eliminated Nikki Bella, who's been, you know, the biggest women's star for a while, I guess, mainstream-wise.
That's true.
We had Nakamura win the Men's Royal Rumble. I think he gets overlooked because of, you know, the history made with the women.
Yeah.
That was probably the best Men's Royal Rumble in years.
Yeah, I did enjoy it. I liked the women's one better, but the men's one was fantastic. I think what really made that Men's Rumble, like, everyone loved was that, like, the final six, the face-off, the new guard versus the old guard. It was Orton, Mysterio, Cena. It was Rollins, Nakers, and Roman. I'm like, Fuck, that's all right.
It was really, really cool.
Bella. Yeah, my apologies.
A very sweaty Finn Bella who was in most of the Royal Rumble.
But no, that was amazing. That face-off photo was so good. I loved it.
And then Nakamura won the Royal Rumble and went on to become champion and became this really, really big star. No, he didn't. we'll get to that. It was really weird. I think those few months were really weird, but we'll get to that. So the Royal Rumble was cool. Ronda Rousey showed up. A lot of people were skeptical. Some people thought, oh, what a weird way to debut her, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Whatever. If we skip from January...
Remember, February was a huge year in Australian. It was a huge month in Australian wrestling.
Actually, don't forget that. I was going to say we'll skip for WWE's sake, but for February in Australia, probably the last ever wrestling show at Festival Hall
here in Melbourne.
Festival Hall, for those who don't know, that is basically this city's wrestling venue historically.
It's our Madison Square Garden. A lot smaller, but it's the prestige of the Madison Square Garden.
In the 60s and 70s, you had international stars from the NWA compete in Melbourne. Dusty Rhodes
came out.
Dusty Rhodes, guys of that era.
Yep.
And the Australian scene at the time was huge.
Yeah, it was massive. They had primetime TV coverage.
Yep, on network TV.
On network television.
So that was a big deal, and New Japan Pro Wrestling put on their first Australian tour. What a weird thing to see Okada, Kenny Omega.
I posted a photo of it the other day on Instagram as a bit of a throwback for me, because I was lucky enough to take photos of that show. It was probably like my crowning achievement so far in my very average career. But it was like taking photos of Okada and Omega in a face-off was honestly something I never thought I'd ever get to do. Like, it was like, and you were there.
Yeah.
The noise when those two got in the ring, when they tagged in for each other, the crowd, I thought the crowd was going to like blow up that arena. It was so insane.
I haven't heard anything like that. That reaction when both guys came in and we got to see that, even on, you know, for just a short time.
It was like maybe a 2-minute trade-off. It was so good though.
And again, the great thing about it wasn't even just the New Japan guys, to see so many Australian talents on that show.
Yeah, so many mates. Just like the opening match was Elliot Sexton, former guest of the show, and Lance Archer, just like doing proper old school big guy wrestling and just beating the crap out of each other for like 6 minutes.
Or so. Yeah, and we had a chat to Elliot Sexton about the tour, you know, briefly on the show.
Yeah,
I think that was a big thing for you know, anyone involved.
Yeah, it was great.
A huge opportunity. And it was big, and there's already talk of another tour coming.
Yeah, I've heard whispers. There is whispers, but we'll see what happens, I guess.
But the fact, yeah, and the fact that New Japan can be so accessible to fans here in Australia.
Yep.
You can watch it online.
What blows my mind is the fact that they don't have TV coverage. They're pretty much, if you're not in Japan, well, actually, they're an internet-based wrestling company.
So that was one of the highlights. Another one of those strange things where you're like, oh, yeah, this happened. And it almost seemed normal because we had Okada here last year.
Yeah.
We've had Will Ospreay.
Yep. Compete. He pretty much lives in Australia.
He even has competed here as the IWGP, you know, junior heavyweight.
Yeah, he has.
Champion. It feels like that's normal.
Yeah.
And like, even to say we've had the announcement of Naito, who missed the New Japan tour.
Yeah, I think he was doing a Mexican or American tour at the time. Yeah.
Yeah, but it wasn't like, oh no, this was just a once-off. It's such a crazy time that it's like, nah, he'll be here in August.
Yeah, he's going to be here in August for MCW, which is the coolest, most ridiculous thing ever.
Yeah, and not just because it's almost like, you know, the home promotion in a lot of ways.
But, and I work for them.
And you work for them. Yeah. Full disclosure, we have to say that.
Okay. Yeah.
But MCW has really made some like really ridiculous waves for wrestling.
Just
this
first half of the year at MCW, again, I'm going to sound really biased and I do apologize, but like, yeah, like in February, yeah, a week after the New Japan show, Will Ospreay versus Mr. Juicy in a ridiculously like good heavyweight versus junior heavyweight versus heavyweight match.
One of the best matches I've seen this year.
Really?
Live.
You loved it that much?
I loved it.
I liked it. But see, that show was full of amazing matches because you had the Robbie Eagles versus Lex ladder match.
Which was insane as well.
Yeah, which was probably one of my favorite two-man ladder matches I think I've seen. Maybe ever.
Yeah, for a one-on-one ladder match, that was insane.
It was so good.
That's the great time we're in. You can have two matches like that on a card, you know, locally.
Yeah.
And there's so much more with MCW, you know, further on in the year.
Yeah.
So we get through that. You know, it's January, it's February. It's like, well, how do things, you know, continue to get better? I feel like this has been one of those years where it's legitimately happened.
Yeah.
WrestleMania this year, that weekend in a lot of ways was probably one of the best WrestleMania weekends in terms of TakeOver and WrestleMania.
I think so. Yeah, actually, the March wasn't that big. Let's be honest, there wasn't that much going on in March from memory. So we'll jump to April.
We'll jump to April.
Because we were there. I think we'd mentioned this all the time.
Yeah, a little bit of a different perspective.
But yeah, we were there. We were at Mania doing our work for all the people we did our work for. And but as you said, there was so much on. But if we're looking at a purely WWE product, the Saturday and Sunday was probably the strongest WWE weekend in a long time for a pay-per-view weekend.
Yeah.
Because obviously, and I think Money in the Bank just gone, like, kind of proved a lot of people's points, but like, NXT, like, TakeOver is always better than the main card. I think Mania was so close to topping TakeOver. Like, inches away from topping TakeOver.
Yeah, everyone seems to have
it. It was my favorite Mania in a very long time, and we all know what I hated about Mania this year.
Yeah, but it was a lot of fun. I watched it back on TV and still enjoyed it. Like, it was a fun show this year, and that fun element has been missing for a while in terms of shocks and surprises. They went for a lot this year, which made it stand out.
It was a long day, though.
It was absolutely.
Like, it was such a long day.
I think we just have to come to terms with that now, that Wrestle Kingdom and WrestleMania,
Kingdom's a 5-hour show. It starts at 5 and finishes at 10. Mania, and then if you get there for the Rumble, with Kingdom, I think we got to the precinct around 2:00 and we left at 11.
Yeah. Settle in all day. That's what it
Mania,
is.
Mania, what? We got to Mania at like 1 and we left at what? 11:30?
Probably.
Like, it's a long, like the two big events are two very long days. But with Mania, I really enjoyed the fact that, like, as you said, obviously Mania caters towards the mainstream audience, mm-hmm. but it satisfied the wrestling fans too.
Like, I think
it satisfied the wrestling fans because, like, that opened with a wrestling match, which was the three-way.
The Intercontinental Triple Threat felt like an old-school, like, classic wrestling Intercontinental title match.
Yep.
And it lived up to that.
Yeah.
You know, Rollins won the belt there. It was really cool.
Oh, yeah.
And then you had a good run.
Yeah, and then you had, like, then there was the big women's, like, the Charlotte Asuka match. Probably my favorite match of the night.
Watching that back, I thought it was probably the best match.
Yeah, you know, watching it on even TV, it was as so I good. Said to you when we were there, I'm like, that was the best match of the night.
It felt really quick in person
and
almost short, but watching it back on TV, it was like, oh, this is really good stuff. Yeah. And again, the shock, Asuka lost. Who thought that would happen at the start of the year?
Everyone expected her to win and then her lose maybe at Mania next year or something. That was what everyone was saying.
Yeah. So that was cool. And then, of course,
the Cena-Taker stuff.
Cena-Taker stuff was a lot of fun because it ran through the whole show. Again, something they haven't really done before. Yeah. An unannounced match unfolding through the show.
Yeah, I think that was great because it kept everyone like... Because I remember a lot of people, like where we were in the media section, like, oh, no, it's not going to happen.
It'll just be a segment or a brawl or, you know.
Yeah, but it was given it was like a 2-minute, like a squash more or less. Yeah. But it satisfied everyone.
Yeah.
It satisfied everyone.
Because you had the crowd staying hyped through the entrance and pretty much through the match because it was short and it was just, wow, what the hell's going on?
Yeah, and it was finally happening.
Yeah. And Taker looked great.
He did. He looked old, but his moveset was great.
Yeah. And then, of course, the tag team mixed tag match that shocked the world, Ronda Rousey.
No one expected her to be that good.
Yeah, you know, you can say it was iffy, the build to WrestleMania. You know, everyone had different opinions on how she should be used or how she was presented as a character.
Yeah.
That night in the ring, Ronda Rousey had a better debut than anyone I can remember. For someone who's never wrestled before.
Yeah, I would agree.
She looked as good as anyone.
She looked better. Funnily enough, she looked better than Angle did on his debut.
Yeah. And I made the comparison in a few different places. But I said she seemed as natural as anyone since Kurt Angle or Brock Lesnar.
Yeah.
And she continues to prove that as she had her second match later in the year
with
Nia Jax.
Yeah, absolutely.
Money in the Bank. That was a match of that night too, I thought.
Is she the Kenny Omega of WWE?
Kenny Omega and Ronda Rousey would have a great match.
Actually, it'd be pretty
just
good.
Just kneeing each other just, and like killing each other.
They'd just hit each other really, really hard and really, like, it would be actually enjoyable.
Probably be really good.
Yeah. But like, quickly going back to TakeOver, The ladder match, that six-man ladder match for the North American title was the most... I've never heard a crowd so hot for 45 minutes.
The entrances to the end of that match...
The crowd was so... like, usually in those big matches, the crowd like kind of waver off a bit, but no, they were on the entire time. Because that match was so ridiculous.
In person, it was so much to take in because they were just going, big stunt, you know, big stunt. Everyone had their time to shine.
Yeah.
And then watching it on TV, I was like, I can't believe they put so much into this.
Yeah, when we got back to Melbourne, I rewatched it when I was unpacking my bags. I'm like, fuck, this match was actually that good on TV too.
Yeah, that might be one of the matches of the year too.
I think so.
And that was only in April.
It was 45 minutes.
It was long.
But it didn't feel like it.
They got a lot of time.
It felt like 20.
Yeah. And for different reasons, might be hard to say, but Velveteen Dream continues to be like one of the absolute standouts in all of pro wrestling, I think.
I think I said on Facebook the other day, he is a big match man.
Yeah.
Like, he is... Give him a big match. Give him a good build because he builds to his pay-per-view matches so well.
Yeah. From the outfits to the entrances to the... Yeah, just everything.
Yeah, it was brilliant.
And we'll get to his other takeover match later in the year as well.
Yep.
So WrestleMania. And again, the shock, the end of the night. We all thought, okay, WrestleMania, this is it for Brock Lesnar. He loses. Roman's a champ. The inevitable. That didn't happen.
Oh, man. There was so much blood.
So much blood.
So much blood.
You know, we haven't seen that much blood in a WWE main event in a very long time.
Probably since Orton and Lesnar.
To just let it flow.
Yeah.
You know.
Just to, like, piss out of his head. It was fountaining out of his head. It was just ridiculous.
Yeah. The WWE saw a few debuts. We had Bobby Lashley return to the company.
We were there, yeah, on Monday Night Raw.
A few people came up, the Authors of Pain.
Yep.
No
Way Jose, who's doing nothing. So there you go.
No way, Jose.
Yeah.
So if we go to post WrestleMania,
yeah,
for the WWE, you know, things settle in, but then we get the crazy announcement of the greatest Royal Rumble. We're all thinking, is this going to be a real show? What are they going to do?
Yeah,
it's a 50-man Royal Rumble,
and I watched all of it. I got up early. I got up. I watched it. I don't know why. But it was very, very interesting.
Because that was in April as well.
Yeah, it was 2 weeks after Mania.
Yeah. It was almost like bonus WrestleMania.
It really was. And it was a 5-hour show.
It was WrestleMania 0.5.
It started at 2 a.m. Melbourne time and finished at 7 a.m.
It might not be a pay-per-view that you go back and watch again. Be like,
I don't think I ever will.
Yeah, you're not going to chuck it on.
There was no matches on there that really like caught my eye either.
But enough happened for a one-time thing while you're watching it. You're like, hey, it's cool. It's bonus wrestling. If you wanted wrestling on that day, you got this giant show in a giant stadium with some odd things about
it. With some big leather couches ringside.
Did you ever want to see waiters give people food during a wrestling match?
I know, this was your show. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then
I love that show too, because everyone was like, okay, this is where Brock loses. It's like, nah,
we're going to keep him still. Does he still have it?
I think he does. He's just at home. It's sitting in his cupboard. Who knows?
He probably just like throws it. He probably busts in the door, kicks the door down, throws it on the recliner and just goes to his room.
Do you reckon he just throws it like with his shoe pile at the front door and he just gets it when he has to leave
the house? I think so.
And Sable's like, Brock, your belt.
She throws it out the door into the tray of his truck and he drives off.
We need a Brock Lesnar and Sable reality show.
Amazing. It would be so interesting.
This guy lives on in the Canadian forest land.
Yeah.
Hunts with his, you know, beautiful wife who was also a former wrestler.
Yeah.
He's got kids and he's just this, what a weird life that man has.
Very weird life.
What a legend. The greatest Royal Rumble, we have to say, of course, sorry, we skipped over at WrestleMania. The weirdness of 2018, Daniel Bryan gets cleared to wrestle.
Yeah.
Has a hell of a showing at WrestleMania. One of the loudest ovations I've ever heard during his entrance.
I legitimately cried.
An emotional moment.
Yeah.
So good to see. He looked like $1 million. Greatest Royal Rumble. He stays in there for over an hour, breaks the all-time record.
Has a black chest.
He looked like... what's his name?
PCO.
PCO from Spring Break.
We'll touch on PCO a bit later. We'll finish the WWE off and then we'll go into other stuff.
So Daniel Bryan's return. I got to say, what's been great about it, you can argue that, he's not champion, they're not using him right. best thing about Daniel Bryan's return is that it feels like he never left. Every match he's in on TV or pay-per-view, you're like, yeah, oh yeah, of course he's that good.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I feel like, and like, and now they team Hell and Noah back together. Like, what the fuck is going on? Again, 2018 in wrestling in a nutshell.
Continues to be, Kane comes out, brings the house down and hugs, you know, Daniel Bryan.
Yeah.
Continues to be a really fun year. So shout out to Daniel Bryan. The fact that he's back is so cool.
It's very cool.
So, oh, and in terms of returns, Rey Mysterio returned at the Royal Rumble.
And the greatest Royal Rumble.
And the greatest Royal Rumble.
Yeah.
And went to New Japan.
Yeah.
He's just...
He's the man.
We've got these cross-promotional things happening.
Yep.
This would never have happened 10 years ago.
Fuck no. No way in hell. No chance in hell.
No, exactly. After the greatest Royal Rumble and WrestleMania season, I think a lot of people were really focused on the Shinsuke Nakamura situation.
Yeah.
You know, he turned heel. He was really doing well.
As AJ Styles said in an interview with Triple M last weekend, he was hitting AJ Styles in the mummy daddy button.
Oh, absolutely.
He just loved just going and just beating the crap out.
We don't know if AJ can add to his family side tattoo. Nakamura's bringing a stop to that.
Yeah, he just starts crossing them.
Nakamura didn't become champion.
No.
You know, they had a lot of pay-per-view matches. WrestleMania, the Great Royal Rumble, and then I think two more after
no
that.
No Mercy. Oh, no.
Backlash?
Backlash, sorry.
And then Money in the Bank.
Had four matches.
Four pay-per-view matches. Plus,
they had like three singles matches on SmackDown too.
They had a killer one on SmackDown. I remember it was probably the best one.
Yeah.
Well, that I enjoyed the most.
Yeah, yeah. They've had close to 10 matches with each other.
How do we wrap that up if that's been the, you know, most continued feud of the year? Was it
and
a
nothing
success?
Actually, I don't think so. It pains me to say it because it was something that like people were looking for so long. Like, they were looking forward to it for so long and it didn't deliver that well.
In a way, it ran through the whole year because, yeah, Nakamura won the Royal Rumble. The feud was set, ran all the way till June, Money in the Bank.
Yep.
Now it's over.
Yeah, and Nakas didn't win the title.
And did they deliver the, you know, five-star classic that everyone said, it's going to happen in WWE and be just as good for different reasons?
I feel like people needed to get their head out of the clouds a little bit and realize that they were never going to have a Wrestle Kingdom 10 match ever again.
Mm. That was just one of those moments.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it was great to say we saw AJ Styles and Nakamura wrestle for the WWE Championship in 2018.
Amazing. At WrestleMania.
At WrestleMania.
Yeah.
You know, so that was cool, but maybe not what we all expected.
Yeah.
Yeah,
moving on with, like, Money in the Bank was the most recent pay-per-view and won. Both Money in the Bank ladder matches were really good. I really enjoyed both of them.
Mm-hmm.
Like quite a lot, but again, I feel like Rousey's match kind of overshone everything, and not because of the fact it was one of Rousey, because the fact it was really good.
Yeah, and in a way, Money in the Bank has set us up for the rest of the year. So Alexa Bliss won the Money in the Bank,
cashed it in
that night, and even though it's like, oh, but she cashed it in already, really, it's set up what's to come next, her feud with Ronda Rousey.
Yeah, and right now Rousey's been suspended. They're doing that whole angle, which I think is great.
Yeah, keeps her off for a little bit, keeps her fresh, builds that anticipation.
So does that mean Rousey, Jax, and Bliss at
SummerSlam? I think there's a triple threat in it first before
Rousey
you go to the singles.
Rousey wins the belt, or do you reckon they'll hold off again and wait until Mania next year?
Maybe Alexa sneaks out a pinfall on Nia Jax.
Yep. You can't pin Rousey.
And who knows? Maybe Rousey wins it later in the year, Charlotte wins the Royal Rumble, and we get to that at
I think other way around.
Oh.
I reckon because they're going for this whole the winner chooses what belt they go for. Charlotte will win a belt, probably the SmackDown belt, because it will add to the whole SmackDown going to Fox Sports.
Oh, that's true.
And then
Rousey wins the Rumble.
Rousey and Charlotte at main event Mania next year.
Yeah, that's a good prediction. I think they will main event.
Yeah, they'll have to main event. You can't not main event.
And probably be the match of the night.
Yeah. Absolutely, because give it, it's a year from now or 10 months from now.
Yeah.
Rousey's just going to get better.
Yeah. And on the men's side of thing, we know where we're going for the rest of the year. Braun Strowman was given the Money in the Bank. In a way, it almost feels like a fail-safe.
Redundant, yeah.
In that they're like, okay, it almost feels like if we knew what was happening backstage, maybe Vince McMahon was like, I still want to go with Roman. And someone else was like, let's just give Braun the Money in the Bank, because if we do that again and it doesn't work, we're just going to go with Strowman.
Yeah.
And I think these rumors of Brock Lesnar like no showing and going to UFC, I think it's just to set things up.
Yeah,
I think so. It's all part of the story.
Yeah,
but it's fun to see unfold.
Yeah, I think it's great, and I'm really excited to see. Like, I don't know. I would have liked to see someone else win the Money in the Bank, like Balor or someone, because we know that like Braun's not had a title anyway. So it's not as if he's going to be like, oh, you know, it's a surprise.
He will win.
Yeah,
yeah. So we know that's happening. In terms of NXT, we've had a hell of a feud with Gargano and Ciampa. It's ran through.
I think it's one of the best feuds of the past 10 years. Yeah. In wrestling, in general. I think I said this to a friend of mine not long ago. I'm like, this feud is like the current, like this decade's El Generico and Kevin Steen.
Yeah, but on a bigger
from
scale.
From Ring of Honor. Yeah, on a way bigger
scale. See it and really feel that, you know?
Yeah, because that feud between Steen and Generico was insane. It went for like 3-4 years. It went for years.
Yeah. Similar in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
You know, two started best tag teams broke up, became super violent.
Yeah.
Watch
their ladder war match from Final Battle. Most insane thing I've ever seen.
Crazy thing is, it feels like it's not over.
Yeah. So a friend of mine said to me, she was like, I reckon they're going to end this in a Hell in a Cell. I'm like, fuck, I reckon you're right.
An NXT Hell in a Cell match.
Yep.
I've heard the idea of a 3 stages of hell.
That'd be gross.
Which I kind of like because it feels like a Triple H thing to do.
And it feels like very like NWA, like old, like late, like very 80s.
Yeah, because in the early days of NXT, the only stipulation match we ever got was best 2 out of 3. That was like the big blow.
Yeah, yeah.
So this feels like taking it to the next level.
Yeah.
Like it's best 2 out of 3.
Well, it is 2 out of 3, but on steroids.
Exactly. I don't think either guy's on steroids, but Ciampa and Gargano look like $1 million.
Ciampa is the most ripped human being. He looks... See, the thing is, with his whole grizzly look now, he looks like he would beat the shit out of you anyway.
Yeah. And also, shout out to them for wearing jeans in a street fight.
Yeah.
I'm a sucker for that. I think it's so good. That's yeah, what they should wear in a street fight.
Even, I love Gargano's entrance with the whole Captain America... like the Captain America jacket, loved it. But yeah, them wearing like proper clothes.
Yeah.
Because yeah. And the same with the unsanctioned match. Well, actually, no, they wore the gear for the unsanctioned match.
They wore the gear because that was, you know, they thought it was still wrestling.
Yeah.
But when it's a street fight.
But what I loved about the unsanctioned match was the ref was wearing a black polo shirt.
Yes, because it was unsanctioned by the company. Yeah. I love those small
So it gets me going, man. Oh, man. Small small thing. About that, we'll quickly jump back to Mania weekend. So we were settling in for that Gargano and Ciampa match, and like it's a match that I've waited for since the turn.
Mm-hmm.
Like I was so excited for it. First 8 minutes, we saw about the first 10 minutes.
Yeah,
I'm like, this is the best thing ever. We get the tap on our shoulder, and our carer is like, "Hey, we gotta go." We're like, "I'm not leaving." Mm. They're like, "We can't leave." And he shows us his phone. He's like, "Press conference at Triple H." I'm like, oh no, I think we should go.
Yeah, we should go now.
So I actually never got to see the match until a week later.
Yeah, we watched it back on TV. We didn't see
Watched it like on the Thursday we got home.
Yeah.
We didn't have time to watch it.
No, like, it was nonstop.
Yeah. But fast forward at the takeover just gone. That street fight was amazing.
I liked the street fight more.
Yeah.
Than the unsanctioned.
Yeah, and I think when Ciampa like undid the canvas, I'm like, I think he's going to win it. Because and then when they did the whole, oh, he's being stretched off and Gargano loses his temper and snaps and beats the crap out of him on the stretcher and throws him into the ring, and then he gets into the ring and there's a short DDT on the planks. So I'm like, great way to finish it.
He's dead. It came into play right at the end, you know, having teased it.
So good.
So that's where NXT is at. Ricochet and Velveteen Dream.
Match of the night.
Another contender for match of the year.
Yeah.
Both of those guys. And again, if we're talking about the small touches. Velveteen Dream. Okay. So he's dressed as Hulk Hogan. That's hilarious. We all loved it.
But it was the gear he was wearing.
And then the gear he was wearing, the tights he was wearing were the Prince Puma tights, which of course Ricochet was Prince Puma in Lucha Underground.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Ricochet for a long time has spoken about he's got a good relationship with The Rock. They go back and forth on social media.
Yeah.
The fact that they did the Hulk Hogan and The Rock like stare down at the start of the match and like both looked at the crowd.
Amazing.
So many small things that the Velveteen Dream does. But he continues to be just a freak.
Just bad interviews. But
or the best at interviews.
Yeah, depends how you look at it. But yeah, then you go, yeah, just the... So his first pay-per-view match was against Aleister Black, and that match was match of the night by... probably one of my favorite matches of the year.
One of last year's best matches.
Absolutely. Easily. And then he was a standout. Looked like he got knocked the fuck out in the ladder match.
Oh, man. He did.
And then... Yeah. And then his match with Ricochet was just incredible.
Yeah.
The guy's a machine.
If we're talking first 6 months in, you know, the WWE scope, Velveteen Dream is maybe the MVP.
Absolutely.
We should touch briefly on the UK scene because it intersects to so many parts of the wrestling landscape for 2018.
Yeah, absolutely.
So here in Australia on a local level, we got Progress, the UK's, you know, hottest promotion, doing cross-promotional shows here.
Yeah, so there was Progress MCW, Progress PWA, and Progress EPW even in Perth.
Yeah, and we can speak of what we saw here in Melbourne.
Yep, and I think we were lucky enough because we had them two nights in a row.
Yeah, it felt like we got two shows.
Yeah, every other promotion had one. We were lucky enough to have two nights, and it was probably two of the big nights in wrestling in Melbourne when you think about it, because like, there was some matches on that card, like the Brat Pack versus Mustache Mountain was amazing. Dowie James versus Tyler Bate was fantastic. Tony Storm's match the next night with Avery, someone who hadn't wrestled for about 6 months, was incredible.
It was a lot of fun. That match was great.
Yeah.
Avery's
Coast to Coast blew my mind.
Getting to see all of these guys and girls have these matches here and for the Australian talent to look just as good.
Yeah.
If we're talking great matches of the year.
Yep.
Find it online and watch it. I can recommend it a lot. Pete Dunne versus Slex.
One of the best matches I think I've ever seen. I think I said this to a lot of people, the best match I've ever seen in my life, and I'm not exaggerating. And I also said that if you don't think Slex is the best wrestler in Australia, you're wrong. And that may be offensive to some of my friends. I do apologize, but Slex, the fact that I think, so full disclosure, I also host the MC, like the Melbourne City Wrestling podcast. I said on that show that since Slex came back in November to face Okada, he's only gotten better. And I think I'm right in saying that.
Yeah.
Like, his match with Okada was amazing. His program with Robbie Eagles was mind-blowing. And then, yeah, his match with Pete Dunne. His match with Nick Armstrong at MCW just gone was amazing too. Like, he's a machine. And then the night before, Pete Dunne had an amazing match with Mike Burr.
Really, really good. Mike Burr's a guy who's been around forever.
20 years.
On the Australian scene.
Yep.
For him to get that opportunity and for both those guys to bring the best out of each other.
Yeah.
Man, Pete Dunne had a hell of a weekend, but Mike Burr and Slex looked just as good in those matches.
Absolutely, yeah. And Slex kicked out of the bitter end. And I've never heard, like, the Thornbury Theatre erupted when Slex kicked out of the bitter end, and then he did the bitter
tombstone.
Bang.
I love it because it wasn't like, oh, he's just going to hit his finisher again. It's like, no, he's going to take it to a new level.
And then Slex did the bitter end as well.
Oh, yeah.
And the crowd lost their mind.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
And Pete Dunne, overall, is one of my favorite wrestlers at the moment.
Okay.
From just everything. His swagger in his entrance.
Yep.
The way he works the crowd. The way he sort of goes from like a bully, but he's also like sort of a hero that you root for. He has this weird balance without really saying much.
Yep.
And I think that's what does it. And then obviously athletically, technically, everything. He's just really, really good. Of course, shout out to Tyler Bate, who I think I said he is basically, his offense is the history of wrestling filtered down into one person. Tyler Bate can do everything.
Yeah.
And he is scary.
Yeah. That match with Dowie was probably one of the most interesting match because they're both known. And what I loved was when I was chatting to Dowie about it afterwards, I'm like, the fact that the crowd didn't get, the fact that the crowd got shitty for the first 5 minutes because they were chain wrestling. Because obviously indie wrestling fans these days, they want to see like big moves and stuff.
Yeah.
But Tyler and Dowie were just like, fuck it, we're just going to chain wrestle and just freestyle wrestle for the first 6 minutes of this match. I don't know, we don't care what everyone says. And I loved it. I thought it was awesome.
Yeah. I think Dowie James deserves a lot of credit too.
Yeah.
He's always solid. Bloody good in that match.
Yeah, very good.
The main event of the triple threat, Elliot Sexton, JXT, Travis Banks.
Oh, my goodness me. I thought JXT died. Oh,
it looked like he did.
I was like, are you okay? He's like, yeah. I'm like, no, are you okay? I'm like, you went headfirst into a fucking barricade. Into
the guardrail. Travis Banks with like the hardest suicide dive I've ever seen.
Yeah. I think that was the coming of age. It sounds funny saying coming of age for someone who was the MCW heavyweight champion for 500 days. But I think that was Sexton's coming of age, that match. He was massive. He was huge in that match. He
looked so good.
Yeah.
Yeah. As a performer, Elliot Sexton is just so fun to watch.
And if you're paying attention to the NXT Instagram story the other day, had a tryout with the WWE.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Ooh. We wish him the best as a former guest and friend of the
show. And a very good friend of ours, yes.
So, you know, that's cool. And then we saw the announcement of NXT UK. That is going to be its own promotion.
Its own promotion, yeah.
Which is just wild. You know, they've got so many great talents. Travis Banks will be a part of that too. So
Ginny, Tony Storm.
Tony Storm as well, yeah.
Yeah. Flash Morgan. I love Flash Morgan. He's cool.
Very entertaining guy.
Yeah.
El Ligero, or just Ligero now. I think they're billing
him. Is it just Ligero?
Yeah, yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
I love his mask though. It's so cool.
Yeah, it's very cool. He's keeping it, I think.
So good. Good. You better be.
So that's crazy. And we also saw for the UK scene the announcement of the World of Sport promotion that is going ahead.
And the fact that Progress is doing a show at Wembley.
Will Ospreay's promotion just launched as well.
Massive turnout for their first show too. And did you see the main event for their second show?
No.
Kaylee Ray versus Viper.
There you go.
Wow.
Viper's pretty cool.
Both great wrestlers.
So the UK has its own thing going now. It's like this.
And I feel like Australia is coming. We're coming. We are on our
Who
own.
Knows? Maybe one day we'll get, you know, NXT Down Under. Yeah, our own promotion.
Yeah.
And speaking of Down Under, we have to say, and then, you know, we've heard the rumors for so long, the MCG WWE Super Showdown is legit. It's happening.
We talked to AJ Styles to come out last week. It's happening. They're coming.
Yeah.
It's going to be amazing. See, I wanted this episode to be short, but my God, it's not going
to
be.
That's why I wanted to do it. 2018, strangest year in wrestling, and we're only halfway through.
Yeah, with New Japan, you've got Jericho winning the IWGP Intercontinental Championship.
Yeah, we should have touched on that, because in the press conference after Wrestle Kingdom, I'm done with New Japan, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Ends up beating Naito for the Intercontinental Championship.
That match was great. Quick little story with that. That show was the same night as MCW show in June, and it was the same time, like the exact same time. Didn't touch my phone, didn't look at anything, didn't look at anyone. About wrestling, I'm like, no, I'm just gonna go home, and I got home and I watched it straight away.
Mm-hmm.
And no spoilers, so I watched the whole show, no spoilers. And I was about 3 o'clock by the time I got to 3 o'clock a.m. by the time I got to Okada and Omega, and goodness me, that match was ridiculous.
We've said a lot. Another match of the year contender.
Yeah, it was an hour and 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Of just wrestling and. Some of the stiffest V-triggers I've ever seen in my life.
That final one especially. And the way they shot it, because they had the camera right waiting at Okada's head, and you just saw Omega like run at the camera basically.
Yeah.
And like, oh
no, he's dead.
You felt it.
And then, I'm going to try and make it real quick. The Golden Lovers reunion was one of the biggest things that happened this year in wrestling.
Another thing that's, you know, been spoken about for years and it finally happened.
And then the crazy world that is pro wrestling. As we said before, PCO, he's a cult hero now in pro wrestling. After that match that we were there at Spring Break when him versus Walter, and his chest turned to as black as my curtains.
Yeah. He's another guy who would never have thought in 2018, you're like, hey, PCO is like, this underground indie, like, cult
icon. And now he's having a match with Riddle.
What is happening?
Insane. Insanity.
Yeah.
And then, just announced the other day, Marufuji versus Kenta, or Hideo Itami as he's now called.
Yep.
WWE guy wrestling on a Noah show.
There's been others we missed. Adam Cole went and did, you know, some other promotions match too.
He's wrestling Walter at Evolve.
There you go. Exactly. So that hasn't happened yet.
It's coming up soon.
So it's coming up. There's all these cross-promotional things, but for the WWE to send Hideo Itami to go and do this match with Marufuji.
Yeah.
What is going on?
And it's a Noah-branded show, but it's Marufuji's 20th anniversary show, because they're a big thing in Japan. You celebrate milestones. Yep. Yeah, yeah. And I watched it the other night. I actually watched it twice. Marafuji versus Noah versus Kenta. I think it was 2004, 2005 for the GHC Heavyweight Championship. The Noah's Heavyweight Championship. Jesus, like the most insane match. One of my favorite matches ever. And then they do a match for the junior heavyweight title as well. Like, these guys have a storied history of 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And they're finally going back to visit. I'm so excited.
If you only know Hideo Itami from 205 Live NXT.
And from Hideo Itami from injuring his shoulder every 12 months. Yeah.
Please watch this match. We assume it'll give you a taste of, you know, what the man.
I'm excited to see that he's going back to Japan so he can be a little more stiffer and everything. So,
yeah. Not that he wasn't. But more.
Yes.
So I think we'll just leave it there. If there's anything we've missed, let us know on Facebook or Twitter.
Yes, please.
What were your highlights of the year so far? Because goddamn, there's been.
Tweet us at RYLAH Podcast or on our Facebook page. Comment and we'll chat about it because there is so much. We've been going for ages. We will see you next week as we rock you like a Hurricane Rana.